a gift. It's a gift. Which doesn't mean that we are not able to be taught how to be baligh, but it is a gift. Some people are better than others in expressing what they mean. And not being baligh is very often the very reason why dispute arises between two people, while each one of them has a good intention. But the way he or she puts the words is not really baligh. Mean لا يوصل معنى المراد. And he is not able to transmit the what that which he intended to say. Okay. وبلاغة المتكلم ملكة يقتدر بها على التعبير. يعني it is a gift or it is a not. يعني which يعني make someone not allowing someone to express himself in a way which is understood about any topic. About any all topic and all goals, you can be baligh. Even if it's a knowledge you have no knowledge about, the balagha is then Allahu A'lam. That would be the balagha. وَيُعْرَفُ أَتَنَافُرُ بِالذَّوْقِ مُخَالَفَةُ الْقِيَاسِ بِالصَّفِ. Now he is referring back to everything we spoke about, the conditions of al-fasaha and so forth. So he says, وَيُعْرَفُ أَتَنَافُرُ بِالذَّوْقِ. He says the tanafur, what was the tanafur again? Either it was tanafur between the letters, or either tanafur between the kalimat. Like, فِي رَفْعِ عَرْشِ الشَّرْعِ مِثْلُكَ يَشْرَعُ. Because it was ثقيل على اللسان, remember? It was heavy. And then in words, letters following each other up. Like for example, vash. What else? Nam mustashzir. What else? you need to memorize it. Hur, khur. And what was al-hur, khur? Nabatun tar'ahu al-ibn. So if you are going to spend your Sunday morning here, then you have to memorize that. Otherwise, it's like I said, no point. Memorize the examples we give. So al-hur, khur. And then about the beautiful water, but it sounds quite strange, was al-ma'a nuqah. So he says, how do we know this? It's bit tadawuk, our dhawq. Meaning there is no real true rule for it. It's rather your, between brackets, Arabic musical ear, being able to distinguish between that which is heavy upon the tongue and that which isn't. So the Arabs would know, but we might not always know unless we know. So now, وَمُخَالَفَةُ qiyas بِالصَّرْفِ. And how will you know whether the word goes against the qiyas, against the morphological pattern, then just isaf, ma'alish. So when it goes against the rules of sarf, then you know it's mukhalafatun al-qiyas. So you can't say that something is mukhalafatun al-qiyas unless you what? Unless you have studied sarf. Which means sometimes it's, and also not because you know sarf that you can now judge that a word is mukhalafatun al-qiyas, because sometimes words are conjugated mukhalafatun lil-asl. Sometimes the words are bent in a way which doesn't really apply to the basic ruling because it's an exception on the rule. So even there, a saf would do really a thing, if you understand me. Okay, but anyway. And then, وَضَعْفُ التَّأْلِيفِ وَالتَّعْقِيدِ اللَّفْظِي بِالنَّحْوِ. Now, and then we spoke about يعني تقديم التأخير, remember, giving precedence to one word over another, or putting it first while it needs to be in second place, and so much more. You only know this from نحو. Then he says, وَالْغَرَابَةُ بِكَثْرَةِ الْإِطِّلَاعِ عَلَى كَلَامِ الْعَرَبِ. And he says, you will know whether a word is rarely used, and this is al-gharaba, rarely used or rarely understood, by reading a lot in the books of the Arabs. No. And he doesn't mean the Arabs today, unless they are linguists. He means the people, especially of Jahiliyyah, where we would take our words and vocabulary from. No. Because of we stopped introducing new words into our vocabulary after the year 150, remember? No? Okay. So the only one whom they would accept new words from was Imam Shafi'i. So after the year 150, after the Hijrah, any new word that they would hear and which wasn't yet written down, they wouldn't accept it. They wouldn't add it to their lexicon or dictionary, whatever. They didn't. Now today we have new words, but these new words all go back to already existing rules. Now, so we can't, we, We can't invent new roots for new words today. We will use things which already, roots which already exist. And in the Arabic language, we don't have a problem with that, right? Washing machine, wasada, the washer, right? The car, sayara, from sara yasiru, you see? And ta'ira, like a tayr, like a bird, ta'ra yatiru. So the pilot is a ta'ir. And the one that is, what, the plane is a ta'ira, and so forth. And then we go, وَتَعْقِيدُ الْمَعْنَوِيُّ بِالْبَيَانِ يعني, and when there is a complex structure, when it comes down to understanding a sentence, you know that through learning bayan. And this is what we are going to do, right? It says, وَالْأَحْوَالُ وَمَقْتَضَيَاتُهَا بِالْمَعَانِ يعني everything in balagha. The last two parts is all in balagha. And we will say more about all of these things in these chapters. فوجب على طالب البلاغة معرفة اللغة والصرف والنحو والمعاني والبيان. He says, so the طالب of البلاغة, and the student of knowledge who wants to learn البلاغة, he should have knowledge, a deep knowledge of لغة. And with لغة, what does he mean? What does he mean with لغة? He needs to have a deep understanding of لغة. With لغة, he's referring to words and vocabulary, right? وصف, morphology, نحو, يعني grammar. And then المعاني والبيان, يعني this we will study in البلاغة. مع كونه سليم الذوق. مع كونه سليم الذوق. It should be a person of taste. No. وكثير الاطلاع على كلام العرب. And he should read a lot in the books of the Arabs. So this last part is like very important. So فوجب على طالب البلاغة معرفة اللغة والصرف والنحو والمعاني والبيان مع كونه سليم الذوق كثير الاطلاع على كلام العرب. Now we will start with علم المعاني. So the علم البلاغة can be divided into three categories. Into علم المعاني, علم البيان, and علم البديع. These are three things. What they are and the reality of these three things will be discussed when we get it, dive into these chapters. But what you need to know for the moment is there is ilmu al-bayan, ilmu al-ma'ani, ilmu al-bayan, and ilmu al-badi'ah. Now, what is ilmu al-ma'ani? The mu'allifun say, هو علم يعرف به أحوال اللفظ العربي التي بها يطابق مقتضى الحال فتختلف صور الكلام لاختلاف الأحوال. Yani, in very brief, he's saying that al-ma'ani is exactly that knowledge which you need to understand which you need to know in order for you to speak ala muqtada al-hal. Do you remember muqtada al-hal? That you speak in harmony with what the situation requires from you. So that is what ilm al-ma'ani does. So when in the ilm of balagha we speak about ilm al-ma'ani, it is teaching you how to speak, not what to say. It is teaching you how to express yourself in a certain situation. Should it be long? Should it be short? Should I start with a question? What does a question mean? And so forth. So this is what this ilm is telling us. And he's getting two examples straight away. فَتَخْتَلِفُ صُوَرُ الْكَلَامِ اخْتِلَافِ الْأَحْوَالِ. Yani, the different ways of putting things are thus, yani, in the light of the situation we find ourselves in. The example we gave Asim, people, they want to you to do islah for them. They don't want to divorce, and you start with at-talaq marratan. You can divorce twice. The kalam is fasih. You are not baligh. Okay. So وَأَنَا لَا نَدْرِي أَشَرٌ أُرِيدَ وَأَنَّ لَا نَدْرِي أَشَرٌ أُرِيدَ بِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ أَرَادَ بِهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ رَشَدًا. Like here, for example, you see that the jinn say, and we don't know whether bad is intended for those who are on the face of the earth, or whether our Lord wants good for them. So here you see something very strange going on. They didn't say, and we don't know whether our Lord wants evil or bad for those on the earth. So they didn't mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when they spoke about good, they said, Rabbuhum. No? So it's from that side. No. Is it clear? So you see that here, and that's the same with غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. But in front of that, before that was what? صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ. the one that you have blessed, not those upon whom is anger and those who went astray. And it wasn't said those with whom you are angry and those who you may go astray. Is that clear? So this is here exactly the same thing. So this is balagha. Now, فَإِنَّمَا قَبْلَ أَمْ سُورَةٌ مِنَ الْكَلَامِ تُخَالِفُ سُورَةً بَعْدَهَا. يعني in this ayah, the sentence before أَمْ, يعني أَمْ أَرَادَ, is not the same kind of structure as the sentence behind or after أَمْ. نعم. He says لِأَنَّ الْأُولَى فِيهَا فِعْلُ الْإِرَادَةِ, because in the first, يعني in the first part before أَمْ, يعني we are mentioning the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah wanting, there is the irada, but it is not attributed to Allah, urida, whether good is intended or wanted, evil is intended or wanted. So it is mabni lil majhul. Now the fact is not mentioned, right? And then wa thaniya fiha fi'lul irada mabni lil ma'lum. And in the second part after am, yani the fa'il, the doer, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the one who wants, is mentioned. وَالْحَالُ الدَّاعِ لِذَلِكِ, and the hal which required this, نِسْبَةُ الْخَيْرِ إِلَيْهِ سُبْحَانَهُ, is that we attribute khair to Allah. وَفِي الثَّانِيَ مَنْعُ نِسْبَةِ الشَّرْ إِلَيْهِ فِي الْأُولَى. Yani is what? Is that we don't attribute shar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though that we believe that Allah jalla wa ala creates evil and good, not evil and bad, and good, and calamities and prosperity. We believe this. We are not of the Mathnawiyya, right? Not the Rumiyya. We are not of those who believe in two gods, the god of...
Dualists. Dualists.
Yes, exactly. We are not dualists. We believe that everything is from Allah. But when we talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, outwardly, we are not going to do this. Okay, is that clear? So that's ta'zim lillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you say, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقْ مِنْ شَرِّي مَا خَلَقْ. Here, is it present or not?
It's who present? Allah. Allah is a mention.
The خَلَقْ, but there is who? Yes. Right? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyway, then it doesn't get into your aqidah issues. So وَيَنْحَصِلُ الْكَلَامُ هُنَا عَلَى هَذَا الْعِلْمِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَبْوَابٍ. So the ilm al-ma'ani can be divided into six chapters or six subdivisions. He says that...
Thamaniyata
abwab.
No, I think in that
case... I have here sittati abwab. Let us see how many abwab it is. Al-bab, who has six and who has eight? Eight? The most likely it will be eight. I have some problems with my copy. Okay. So al-bab al-awwal al-khabar wal-insha'. How would we translate al-khabar wal-insha', Hasim?
Khabar is a sentence that once you finish saying something.
No, translation, not explanation.
Oh, khabar is information.
Informative sentence. And an insha?
An uninformative sentence.
And what?
Uninformative.
Uninformative sentence. If it doesn't exist, at least you know what we mean. So, khabar is an informative sentence, and an insha is an uninformative sentence. So كُلُّ كَلَامٍ فَهُوَ إِمَّا خَبَرٌ أَوْ إِنْشَاء. So each sentence is either a khabar, yani informing, or either it is insha. It is not informing, but it is what? An uninformative sentence. What do I mean? Like for example, a question. Now it is Muhammad running home? But if I say, do, speak, am I informing or not? This is what he's going to talk about. Okay. Well, khabar, and this is the most important one. The khabar, and this is an explanation. ما يصح أن يقال لقائله إنه صادق. إنه صادق فيه أو كاذب. يعني the khabar is every sentence when somebody says that sentence that it can be true or it can be false. No. كسافر محمد. Like when someone says, Muhammad is traveling. This can be true and this can be false. And we say, Aliyun Muqeem. Ali is a resident. This can be true and this can be false. The insha, مَا لَا يَصِحُ أَن يُقَالَ لِقَائِلِهِ ذَلِكَ. And the insha is a sentence which is not open to truth or falsehood, meaning like a question, asa, or a command, like safir ya Muhammad, like travel O Muhammad, or aqim ya Ali, be a resident O Ali. You can't say you're lying, right? Okay. But if I say nazal al matar min al sama, now or talaat al shamsu, the sun has risen, then this can be true or false. Okay. والمراد بصدق الخبر مطابقته للواقع. Now, so when the khabar is true, now, then we are going to call this sidq al khabar. Now, so when that which you have been informed, or if that which you have been told is true, then this is that which has been said is sidq al khabar. وَبِكَذَبِهِ عَدَمُ مُطَابَقَتِهِ لَهُ. And if it's not true, we call this كَذِبُ الْخَبَرِ. فَجُمْلَةُ عَلِيٍ Yes.
مُطَابَقَةً لِلْوَاقِعِ.
No, then it's conformed to the actuality.
What about if you think it's true, but it's not actually?
Then it doesn't take it away from the fact that it is a خَبَر, not an إِنْشَاء, right? So we're not looking into the hukum. If you say it and you think it's true but it isn't, then we call this wahm. It's just wahm. Okay. But it does make it true. You thinking it doesn't make it true. No. So it's still kadhib al khabar. But we won't call you kadhab. Okay. But the khabar is not conformed to the reality, so it's still kadhib al khabar. فَجُمْلَةُ عَلِيٌ مُقِيمٌ So the sentence Ali is a resident. إِنْ كَانَتِ النِّسْبَةُ الْمَفْهُومَةُ مِنْهَا مُطَابِقَةً لِمَا فِي الْخَارِجِ فَصِدْقٌ وَإِلَّا فَكَذِبٌ Yani if you say Ali is a resident and he truly is a resident, we say this is صِدْقُ الْخَبَرُ, and when he isn't, then we call this I need a bit more reply. كَذِبُ الْخَبَرُ So this is easy going. The best thing, as I told you last time, to do is to make diagrams for yourself. You just go khabar, insha, subjected to truth and falsehood, not subjected to truth and falsehood. Then you go down, you say kadhibul khabar, sidqul khabar, sentence. And if you do it like that, like this, and you mind map it, you do that with the entire book. That's what I did, or used to do, and still do actually. Like when I read a book, I really turn it into diagrams. And then, subhanAllah, because then when you visualize your knowledge, And everybody has his own way to mind map things, then it will, you know, stay in your mind. Otherwise, it will just leave you. وَلِكُلِّ جُمْلَةٍ رُكْنَانٍ This is a very important one. Do we have a qalam? لِكُلِّ جُمْلَةٍ رُكْنَانٍ Every sentence has two pillars. How many?
Two.
مَحْكُومٌ عَلَيْهِ وَمَحْكُومٌ بِهِ Okay. When we say مَحْكُوم, we don't mean judged and ruled over. Try to put it like this: that which is this, that which is described, and that which it has been described with, or that which has been attributed to something, and that which something has been attributed to. Okay. Two ways. Okay. So the first one was what? Was what? Yes, so that which has been described and that which it has been described with, or that which is attributed to something and then that which it has been attributed to. Yes.
One that I normally use is just a subject of a sentence, the thing you're talking about.
I didn't know that it was called like that. So that's why I told you at the very beginning, I'm not an English native speaker, so I'm just sharing yani the thoughts, and if you understand what I mean, then that's sufficient, inshallah. So وَيُسَمَّ الْأَوَّلْ So the mahkum alayhi, okay. Does everybody know mubtada and khabar? Yeah. We have here. Al-baytu jamilun. Okay, so we have al-baytu jamilun. We said that which is described. The that which it has been described with. So what is being described? Al-Bayt. And what is describing the Bayt? I mean, which is the Mahkum and which is the Mahkum Alayhi or Mahkum Bihi?
Al-Bayt is Mahkum Alayhi.
Okay, so Al-Bayt is Mahkum Bihi, right? And what is Jameel? Don't follow me in my explanation, right? It's not correct.
Isn't Al-Bayt Mahkum Alayhi? Oh, okay.
Al-Bayt is Mahkum Alayhi. I told you, like some of my mashayikh, I want to see whether you're awake or not. So this is mahkum alayhi, no? And it is what? Mahkum bil jalal, no? So this is mahkum bihi, okay? This is a mubtada, this is a khabar, no? So here, is this a khabar or is this an insha? Khabar, okay? So this is a khabar. Why is it khabar? Why is it a khabar? Because the sentence is subjected to truth or falsehood. I know that it's very relative to say whether a bait is beautiful or not, but in general, people seem to agree that if you enter into a place and everything is like
dirty
and you won't see it. So, but your philosophical debate, I was expecting it. So this is very relative. What is beautiful to some is not beautiful to others. Okay, but anyway, al-baytu jameel is a khabar. Why? Because it is subjected to silk or to kevin. Okay. Now, what would I do to turn this into insha? Excuse me? Okay. So, hal, right? Hal, hal al-bayt, jameel. So now all of a sudden, it became an insha. Okay? And here there is no sidq, and there is no kadhib, because it's not subjected to truth or falsehood. So this is what he is saying. So we have al-mahkum alayhi and we have al-mahkum bihi. Okay? So you have it there in front of you. He said, وَيُسَمَّ الْأَوَّلُ مُسْنَدًا إِلَيْهِ. The mahkum alayhi is that to which something has been attributed. Okay? So that's the musnad ilayhi. You attribute it to it, something to it. Like the fa'il, like someone doing something. Give an example of the fa'il. And what if I were to say Zaydun Daraba? What would that mean?
Jumla ismiya.
Why?
Because he put on ism.
Ahsan. So we would say Daraba Zaydun
Amra.
Why always Daraba?
Daraba can also mean to give a speech, no?
Is that what you meant?
Yeah, no.
Daraba has more than seven meanings. Daraba Zaydun Al-Hajara. Okay? Daraba Zaydun al-Hajara. So what did I do now? Zayd is the one doing something. And hitting is being attributed to him. So the fa'il is being attributed to. So it's the muhkam alayhi. And what has been attributed to him?
Hitting.
No, hitting. No problem. So then the hitting would be mahkum?
Yes, hitting the door.
Yes, okay. Is that clear? Okay. So let's continue. وَيُسَمَّ الْأَوَّلُ مُسْنَدْ إِلَيْهِ. So Zayd is musnad ilayhi and what? The hitting is musnad, is that which has been attributed. Okay, and then he says وَنَائِبِهِ, yani that which replaces the fa'il, like na'ibul fa'il. Like for example, futihat as-sama. If I were to say futihat as-sama, okay, is it futihat as-sama'u or futihat as-sama'a? Right? Futihat as-sama'u. So now, this is for you. Where is the musnad and where is the musnad ilayhi? Or where is the mahkum bihi and the mahkum alayhi? Yes? The mahkum alayhi would be sama, because that is the thing which has been attributed to. Yeah? And then? The mahkum bihi futihat. Or and what would be the musnad? What would be the musnad ilayhi here? Futihat is what? No. Futihat is the musnad, that which has been attributed to what? To the musnad ilayhi, which is the sama. Okay, is this khabar or insha? It's a khabar. Is it? You know what we need to do? Like, for example, this is an ayah from the Quran. So here we are going to watch out what we're about to say. Because if we just say it's a khabar, then we would say that it's subjected to truth and falsehood. Which in the case of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not true. So it's not true because He's. Yes.
So is the whole Quran by definition in shirk?
No, it's a khabarun ilahi. And the khabarun ilahi, la yatatarrahu lahu kadhibun abada. And that, so we call it a khabarun ilahi. It's not insha, because insha would be only a command or a question. And there is more here. There is truly khabar. But this is وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a khabir. So there is khabar, but it is وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا and حَدِيثًا. You see? So this is why. So when we talk about the khabar, when it comes down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't just say khabar. We are going to do ta'zeem of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words, and we're going to say khabarun ilahi. Okay, is that clear? That's the same what we do when we are deducting a sentence from a grammatical point of view, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anywhere we would say ittaqi allaha. We're not going to say Allah is maf'ul bihi, the dom too, the subject. The subject? No, the object. Allah is never an object, He's always the doer. So we are going to say, yani, we're going to say, lafdul jalala fi mahalli maf'ul bihi mansub. You see? Or they are going to say, lafdul jalala mansub ala al maf'uliyya. You see? So that you say that the lafd is ala al maf'uliyya, not the haqiqa of man tasamma bihad al ism. So this is why it's very important that also in grammar, we are always going to respect the lafdul jalala. No. I already explained in one of the previous classes that I don't believe that in the Quran we have a harf zaid. I don't believe this. For those who are not reading to grammar, it actually means that a letter, for example, has no real grammatical function, or it doesn't add an extra something to the meaning of an ayah, which would be wrong because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say anything without a reason. And everything He says, is beneficial. Okay? So this is why it's important not to, even there. While some others might say, yes, it's Zaid, but I don't use Zaid. There is no Zaid in the Quran. No. So now we know, وَلِكُلِّ جُمْلَةٍ, so for each sentence, without regards being khabar or insha, yani there are two pillars. مَحْكُومٌ عَلَيْهِ وَمَحْكُومٌ بِهِ. So now what you need to know is, what are they? They are the core of a sentence. Meaning that a sentence can't do without them. So now if I were to say here the same thing, like wa fikum, I were to say here, this I feel like attached, which I am. Okay. So here, if I were to say al-baytu jamilun jiddan, the house is beautiful, very, yani very beautiful, can I do without very?
Yes,
would still make sense. So is this a rukun? Would this be a rukun of the jumla? It is not. Usually the mansubat, now the mansubat, those who are in the state of a nasb words, are usually not needed as long as they are not the core of a sentence like mubtada and khabar, which are preceded by kana or inna wa akhawatuha, because then it's still a mansub, which is a rukn of the jumla. Okay, but as if not, then all the mansubat, like for example, jaa Muhammadun rakiban. Muhammad came mounted, yani riding a horse or a donkey or whatever. So now this rakiban, is it needed or is jaa Muhammad, knowing that Muhammad came, is sufficient? Okay, so all these other things which are not of the arkan jumla, we call fadla. Fadla,
we are going to
with a god. Fadla. Okay, so you can do without them. So they are not from the arkan jumla. As I said, the mansubat, yani those in the state of a nasb. But if I were to say inna al-bayta jamilun, al-bayt here has a fatha in the state of a nasb because it's ism inna mansub. Then here I'm still going to say, even though it's mansub, it what is rukn al-jumla. Why? Because it's the asl of the jumla. Okay, in origin it was a mubtada, which is now the ism of inna. So, ولكل جملة ركنان محكوم عليه ومحكوم به ويسمى الأول مسندا إليه كالفاعل ونائبه ومبتدأ الذي له خبر ويسمى الثاني مسندا كالفعل والمبتدأ المكتفي بمرفوعه. I'm not getting into details there. Let's continue. الكلام على الخبر. Now, why not? Because if you have only a mubtada, then it is not musnad ilayhi, is it? So it's an exception. And what do they mean? If you just have one word, and the khabar is not mentioned, like man anta Muhammadun. So even though that here, if you say Muhammad, actually we say that it is a sentence because it's muqaddar, yani it's implicit. There are one word is implicit and one word is explicit. So actually, when someone says to ask you man hada, yani who is that, or then you say Muhammad, and you actually mean huwa Muhammad. أو الرجل الذي تسألني عنه فهو محمد. You see. So anyway, الكلام على الخبر. This is nice. الخبر. The خبر. What was the خبر again? Who reminds me? A خبر is a sentence.
Well, you can say it's true or false.
With subjected to truth or falsehood. If it is true, then we talk about Sidqul khabar. If it is false, we talk about Kadibul khabar. Okay. When we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't just say khabar, we say khabar ilahi, which is never subjected to falsehood. Not but always to truth. So now the khabar, yani the word, the sentence which is subjected to truth and falsehood, yani imma an yakuna jumla fi'liya aw ismiya. It can either be a nominative sentence, meaning that either the sentence starts with, not with a fi'l, not with a verb, or that all the words in the sentence are asma, or are not verbs. Like for example, ash-shamsu jamilatu, or for example, Zaydu musafirun, Zayd is traveling, a traveler. Zayd is a traveler. But if it starts with a fi'l, with a verb, then it's not a nominative sentence, but a
verbal sentence.
A what?
Verbal
sentence. Like, daraba Zaydun, takallama Zaydun, jaa Muhammadun, and so forth. So, al-kalamu ala al-khabar, so the sentence is either ismiya, a nominative sentence, or either fi'liya, which is a verbal sentence. No. He says, فالأولى, so the جملة الفعلية موضوعة لإفادة الحدوث في زمن مخصوص مع الاختصار. So he says, yani that the verbal sentence is a sentence which shows us that something has happened or is happening or will be happening. Has happened, is happening, or will be happening. مع الاختصار. He says, and this is to shorten things, because if I say, يسافر محمد, it's shorter than إِنَّ مُحَمَّدٌ لَمُسَافِرٌ. Now, which it would not be a verb. It is a describing his state that he is a traveler. So a verbal sentence will allow you to cut things short instead of making things longer. So وَقَدْ تُفِيدُ الْإِسْتِمْرَارَ التَّجَدُّدِيَّ بِالْقَرَائِنِ. Yani the fi'l can also show that something keeps on happening. Like, for example, if we say وَكَانَ اللَّهُ. No, not that one. Give me an example, Asim, of a fi'l يَتَجَدَّد. Because this would be a fi'l naqis, isn't it?
Yes, but isn't it still a fi'l?
It's still a fi'l. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ. And Allah was always forgiving. So the was in the Madi. No? So the when something is mentioned in the Madi, then and the context shows that it's an ongoing thing, then we say that كَانَ is إِثْبَاتِ الْأَمْرِ عَلَى الْإِسْتِمْرَارِيَّةِ وَالْوُجُودِيَّةِ وَعَلَى and so forth. So it means that something is always there. I want you to take Surah Ar-Rum in front of you, please. Take Surah Ar-Rum in front of you. On your phones. Excuse me? Subhan, do you also have that prayer app? But now they have a lot of
games.
No, not games. How do you call that? Publicity or
notifications?
No. Advertisement.
Yes. Sometimes I really speak like a good way. That's Surah Al-Rum. Okay, that's Surah 30. Then I want you to have a look up. There is advertisement again. Go on the right page. Oh no, you have the Pakistani version. Okay. Someone with an Arabic version of the Quran? I mean the Arabic print? Oh, you have it on your laptop, so you don't know which page is left and right.
What Arabic as well?
Excuse me?
Mine's in Arabic too.
Pakistani Arabic.
So this is really difficult. Okay, good. I want you to go to verse number 15. Okay, so here when we read, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ يَوْمَ خَيْرٍ فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ فَهُمْ فِي رَوْضَةٍ يُحْبَرُونَ. Is that a fi'l or not? يُحْبَرُونَ. It's a fi'l. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about people in paradise that they will be allowed to do the ihbar. So they will enjoy their and whatsoever. It's in the form of a fi'l. When you look at the next one, you see وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَلِقَاءِ الْآخِرَةِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ فِي الْعَذَابِ مُحْضَرُونَ. Is this a fi'l? This is not a fi'l. No? It's okay. No? So in the first one, it's يُحْبَرُونَ. That the people in paradise, يُحْبَرُونَ. يعني the fi'l is attributed to them. Why? Because the fi'l, yani in the form of the mudari, being in passive or active, shows a tajaddud, means that something is renewing itself over and over again. It's always different, it's always new. When he speaks about the people of hell, he says yani that they are what? Muhdar. Meaning they are there and they are in a state, they're not in a fear.
It's not changing.
It's not changing, it's always the same thing. You know? And this is, when it comes down to torture, that's the most difficult thing, that you know what is going to happen. Because you have been subjected to this pain, you know exactly what it feels like, and you know exactly when it's coming. So while you are waiting for it to come down upon you, then this is already adab. And this is why one of the worst punishments or tortures were of the Chinese, with the drip always falling on the same place on your skull. So they would just attach you by your neck, and a drip would fall down like every 15 seconds or 30 seconds. And the brain calculates this, so it knows when it's coming. So before it comes, it's like this. But because it always comes on the same spot, at the end, it's like thunder on your head. And eventually it will just, you know, go through your bone and everything, because it's always on the same spot, day after day after day. So the people in Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they are in a state, yani, which they are in, which is always the same, it's never changing. But when he speaks about the people of paradise, he attributes the fear to them. Like he says about Jannah this, and immediately about after that, Jahannam. So there is a reason for the fear here and a state there. Is that clear? So this is the importance of knowing the differences. And that's balagha. This is like a very beautiful example of balagha. Okay. Did you get the example? Okay. And someone has the translation with him over. And it's not really translation, interpretation.
Then those who had believed and had done righteous deeds, they will be in a garden extremely delighted.
Okay.
And as for those who had disbelieved and rejected our verses in the meeting of the hereafter, they will be brought for punishment.
Not wrong, right? They didn't make that difference in Balaha. Yeah, it doesn't matter. I don't doubt his knowledge.
Let me find someone else. Oh, I don't have the clue.
But very often you will see that when there is a translation, that very often they don't look into the balagha.
It'd be hard to translate the law without adding extra words. Or
we have to. We have to. If we really want to do it, then we have to. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for example, with uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah. Now, very often it will be said, reside therein, abide therein, or whatever. But if we are going to look at the word uskun, it has the root letter sakana, sin kaf nun. And these are the same letters we can find, for example, in the word sakina, tranquility. The same word, group letters we find in miskin, which we call a poor person. And the same root letters which we find in the word sikin, yani, knife. But if we look at it and we're going to translate it, then we need to translate it in the light of the root letters. So we're not going to say sikin, knife. Sikin is that which brings something at rest. Like it brings an end to moving things. And the miskin is called miskin because he has got no money, so usually he just remains in the same place. So he doesn't move around. You see, and sakina brings your heart at rest, so that you don't go left and right, because you have found in your heart what you need. So when you say, when Allah says, uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah, Adam already knew that being in Jannah was only temporary. Because Allah didn't say, live in Jannah. He said, come at rest in Jannah. And when you need to come at rest, you know that it's to prepare yourself for something else. So he had to prepare himself in Jannah, come at rest, be energized, so that later on he could go to the face of the earth, you see. So if and then our tafsir will change, because from this we take away from a practical point of view that whenever you want to do something difficult in your life, then let it be preceded by rest, you see. So and if we are not going to look at the Quran from this perspective, then we are going to have a problem. And then the beauty is not being reflected. Like, same thing, تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ أَنْ تَجْرِي تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارُ. It's not the same thing, is it? مِن تَحْتِهَا تَحْتَهَا. In the Arabic language, مِن تَحْتِهَا means like right beneath it. And تَحْتَهَا can be thousands of meters beneath it. So when you say تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا تَحْتَهَا, then there are three kinds of rivers in paradise. No? So one is just above us, like in a hadith. But the other one would be that the soil will be transparent, and very deep under your feet you will see the rivers flowing. But some will just be underneath the soil, so you will feel the water, you know, like massaging your feet, right? But it won't wetten you, because it's min tahtiha, but nevertheless you feel like the flow of the water going and caressing you on the soles of your feet. So if you look at this, then, you know, Jannah is just the perfect place. It's not just, rivers flowing around. No. They do everything which, you know, you like. Is that clear? So, تَجْرِي تَحْتَهَا مِن تَحْتِهَا and so forth.
I've got Dr. Abdul Halim's translation.
Of?
That same.
تَحْتَهَا مِن تَحْتِهَا.
No. You can go on.
Okay, yes.
He it's a bit similar. When the hour arrives on that day, people will be separated. Those who believed and did good deeds will delight in the garden, while those who disbelieve and denied our messages and the meeting of the hereafter will be bought for punishment.
Okay, but Habibi, can I ask you a question? What does it say in Arabic, in the just the last word of the ayah, number 15?
Yuhdarun. Will be made to delight.
Yes. Because if you say yuhdarun, they will delight. When you say yuhdarun, it means you have been granted, you have been allowed, you have been chosen. So that you understand the blessing of being there. Meaning yuhdarun, it's inspiring us and reminding us that the people in Jannah will never forget that it's a blessing of Allah. Is that clear? Exactly like the people in Nahr, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. They are aware. And the people in Jannah, إِنَّا كُنَّا قَبُوا فِي أَهْلِنَا مُشْفِقِينَ فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ. So in Jannah they are aware of the fact that they are enjoying Jannah thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the state and the mabni lil majhul is used here. You see this? So I believe that if you want to go to a translation, that we need to take all these things into account. Otherwise we will fall short. And it will take longer and it will be much larger, but people will like taste due to the language. And the last example I want to give is, for example, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Yani there are those who will prosper, those who will be successful and this and that. Is that mean of muflihun? We go back to the roots. Falaha. And falaha is like a farmer. We call him falah. And a falah is someone who will harvest what he cultivates. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says humul muflihun, it are only those who will harvest the rewards for these good deeds which have been mentioned, which is yu'minuna bil ghaybi wa yuqimuna salata wa mimma razaqnahum. You see? So this is why we need to go back to al-balagha al-Qur'aniyya. And then when we share it with people, it's like you have now a 3D image, if I can say that, or 4D. It's like so much more beautiful, like fa'ummu hawiya. What is ummu? Al-qari'a, same thing. How do they translate qari'a?
Is it the knocking?
Yeah, it's qara'a is also, knocking the door with your nails. It's qara'a, yaqra'u. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says qari'a, man qari'a, wa ma adraka man qari'a, yani, should I let you know what that is which will scratch your heart, yani, so that you will be moved, yani, with horror or by horror, you see? So it's qari'a, nakhira, and nakhira, same thing.
Yeah, and the crushing blow for the qari'a.
Yeah. So that's why we need you, Asim.
We need you.
No, my English, I don't know even how to say it.
I'll teach English.
I can explain you like in my way, but my English is so bad. Alhamdulillah, thank you for allowing me to talk to you. So we will come at rest for 5 minutes, inshallah, and then we continue immediately. So I think we saw a lot, but I would like you to go out of the room. It's just write everything down, make these mind maps, memorize. A talib al-ilm without memorization is no talib al-ilm. It's just someone with a book in his hand. No?